Hello, welcome to Queer Say. I'm Andrew Kay, and my guest today is Ivor Chaplin. Hello again, Ivor.
Hello again, Andrew. Good to be here.
Looking as smart as you were yesterday.
I know.
Which is probably because yesterday and today are the same day.
It's the wonder of television.
Strange world.
Wonder of television.
I do try so hard to find great news stories and triumphs from the LGBT plus world for the programme, but there are moments when you find something and you just think, can this really be happening in 2017?
Yeah.
And unfortunately it is, and the first story today is about a Jamaican gay activist, Dexter Pottinger, who's been found murdered in his home. I mean, the details of the story are pretty grim. He's been stabbed, his body has been found partly decomposed. And there's an element though here that he was also a victim of theft, and you have to question, is this an opportunistic killing in which he happens to be gay, or has he been targeted because he's gay?
The answer is we don't know.
Well, I don't think we'll ever know.
And we may never know.
Unless the culprits are found.
Yeah. I mean, it's a dreadful story. It's dreadful for him, obviously, his family and his friends in Jamaica. I mean, it is still, you know, a Commonwealth country, which, in my view, needs to, you know, get itself up to date. And it's not showing any signs of doing that, which is really, really quite upsetting, I think, to those of us who think the Caribbean is actually, you know, an important part of both world politics and the Commonwealth itself.
And yet homophobia there is probably worse than almost anywhere. It is terrifying. Do you feel that as gay men and women bi and trans and whatever we are, do you feel we should boycott these countries where homophobia is so prevalent as holiday destinations?
I don't think I would go there, I have to say. I mean, I've been to the Caribbean for business reasons, but I don't think, would we go on holiday there? I don't think we would.
Did you experience homophobia when you were there?
I mean, the only problem there is you're in a meeting, you know, you're there for a short period of time, it's in, out, and away you go.
I mean,
it's difficult to say yes or no to that. But knowing what you know, especially now, because it seems to be more pronounced in the last 10 or 15 years, maybe as the rest of the world has become more open to all LGBT.
I suppose if we're swinging in one direction, even if that's staying in the same position, it's going to be a bigger gap, isn't it?
Yes, it is. That gap is great. But this is a terrible story, and it came in a week also when, of course, Dean Eastman passed away from his cancer, who's written for Attitude and various gay magazines, which was a sad case as well. And our thoughts are with him and his friends and his family as well. But this was a terrible story, and it seems to be very, very violent.
It sounds like it was horrific.
Yeah.
It sounds also like he was quite an extraordinary man and very open about his sexuality.
Yeah.
Very visible on many levels, as a designer, as an artist, working in so many fields.
I mean, it's a bit of irony here that the minister, who's known as the Minister of Culture, Gender, Entertainment and Sports, you know, is saying, I consider Dexter to be an exceptional artist. His designs were works of art. He starred many of our popular entertainers and helped set the style trend in dancehall. His music videos were also epic. We have lost a really talented Jamaican.
Yeah.
You know, I struggle to understand a minister in a government saying that in a country which is so blatantly homophobic.
And allows it to continue. So it needs to be. And we're going to stay on that side of
the world.
The world.
We are.
With this next story, which I think this is actually very worrying. And this is the fact that Bermuda could be the first country in the world to re-ban same-sex marriage. This is a very retrogressive step.
This would be incredibly unhelpful, I think, to how things are. And just a little bit of history here, a little bit of background. In Bermuda, the country's Supreme Court, I think over a year or 2 years ago, finally approved same-sex marriage.
Yes.
And there were huge delight across the LGBT community in Bermuda about that happening. Now, one MP has introduced a bill.
This is Wayne Ferbert.
Reban, what was his name? Wayne Ferbert, yes.
He just sounds like a redneck, doesn't he, that name? Sounds like a sort of fictional name for someone who's going to do this.
And I'm struggling to understand whether this is the same sort of thing as a private member's bill in the House of Commons. Because if it is, then it would need government support, private member's bill to get through, would need government support. But the government here seems to say our position is that same-sex couples should have all the legal rights of heterosexual couples, save for marriage.
So it is a backward step.
It is sounding like that. Now, whether the Supreme Court, having made a decision that same-sex marriage in Bermuda is legal, will accept that Parliament can change this thing. I mean, there is that potential battle between Parliament and the courts.
Mm.
Very strange story. One to keep an eye on, I think.
I think it's definitely one to keep an eye on because I think if it happens, it could trigger a trend. And these are the things that we actually must fight against.
I think it does still, people say to me, why do you need pride? Well, these reasons around the world that in this programme and in other programmes we've talked about are reasons why we need pride. Because whilst we have good LGBT rights here, still progressing forward, we need to make sure there's no going backwards in other countries around the world.
Absolutely. I think you're absolutely right. We can't be complacent because we have achieved so much in this country about what's happening in other countries in the world. And I find this one actually worrying, although it's not violent and it's unpleasant in the sense of Chechnya and the previous story about a murder. It's actually very worrying that people can start to think that this is okay.
But unfortunately, you know, single MPs with not much else to do can make a name for themselves by putting this sort of thing forward. Maybe, you know, electoral stunts and all that sort of, you know.
So you think he might be a heat-seeking missile looking for the glamour of media attention? You must have seen lots of that. You must have seen lots of that.
What can I say? What can I say?
You're not going to say I can't possibly comment, are you?
No, I'm not. No. It brings us on to the next story, though, doesn't it? Because that is one of those stories.
I think it's the most wonderful story on so many levels that I had to stop and have a cup of tea after I found this one.
Really?
This is gay man becomes mayor of hell and bans all straight people from his town. So we need to qualify this. Hell is a town
in
Michigan.
In Michigan.
Which I love the idea that there's a town called hell. I mean, I've lived in towns that have been like hell, but not been called hell. And then he was newly appointed mayor of hell and he announced a ban on all straight people from entering his town, calling them a radical threat and promising to make hell great again.
I mean, he's obviously got a sense of humour that appeals to both you and I. I don't think there's any doubt about that. Because as he goes on with his various missives, he says that he's thinking of impeaching himself at the same time. And all sorts of things. So, it's an incredible story. He's the acting mayor of hell, and he hereby ban all heterosexuals from entering our town. And apparently, he is also the guy who developed the Donald Trump starring gay erotica became an Amazon bestseller last year.
Absolutely.
I mean,
wonderful.
He's got a style that you have to admire. I mean, there's no doubt about that.
Well, he is, in fact, that heat-seeking media attention-grabbing.
He is. Which is why I was waiting for this story to use that phrase rather than previously.
I love this line from that Amazon bestseller, and this is talking about Trump. His gorgeous ass flapped behind him like a mouth-watering stack of pancakes. That so puts me off wanting to eat pancakes.
But if anyone knows anything about pancakes, it's the Americans.
Oh,
they do
true.
Love their pancakes.
Very true.
I think I might make a trip to hell in Michigan at some stage. I think that'd be worth doing.
I
want to see the welcome to hell sign.
I really want to meet,
and meet
Elijah Daniel.
Yeah.
Because I think he's, I mean, if you ever get to see this, Elijah, please come and be on the show. Because I think you're wonderful. I think this is such a funny story. But actually, he's making a really great statement that a lot more people could make. And what he's basically saying is that we're all the same. So if you want to ban gay people, then I'm happy to say, well, let's ban heterosexuals.
He finishes with a great quote where he says, all hetero residents, his words, who do not participate in reparative therapy will be required to wear a Scarlet H and meet in the town centre at 5:30 a.m. wearing cargo shorts every morning to be publicly straight-shamed. Brilliant, brilliant, brilliant.
He's wonderful. He's
absolutely brilliant story. Brilliant story.
We need people like this in this country.
We need people anywhere just to give us this light relief from some of the serious stuff.
I'd love to have some sort of activist in Brighton who's saying, not that we need it so much here because we are the most wonderful,
maybe our current,
accepting
our current mayor could invite Mayor Daniel over for a visit.
The lovely Mo.
The lovely Mo could invite him over. So, what about that idea?
Maureen Marsh, Lady Mayor of Brighton and Hove, currently, please, we would like you to invite Elijah Daniel over to make a statement about this for Brighton and Hove. We're going to go to a break on that very jolly note, and I hope Mo's listening. So, we've got just a moment left. Before we move on, we're going to come on to some serious stories, and one of these is one that worries me greatly. And after the break, we're going to be talking about the whole concept of gay cures. Mm. I find that really upsetting.
It is, and we will deal with that.
We'll come back in a moment, but for now, we're going to go to some ads. We'll see you in a few moments. Welcome back to QueerSay. I'm Andrew Kay. My guest today is Ivor Chaplin. Before the break, I mentioned that we were going to talk about gay cures and it being a subject that really deeply worries me, that there are still people who think that this is something that can be cured. I'm not ill. You're not ill, are you?
I'm not ill, no.
Not ill.
I'm very well.
A bit of a bad throat at the moment, but other than that, I don't see that my sexuality is an illness, but so many people seem to think that it's curable.
Well, and we've had some of this both locally and nationally recently in the UK, haven't we, of course?
Well, we had incident of this during the recent election.
We did.
With a candidate down in Hove.
We did. The candidate in Hove was from an organisation which promoted gay cure therapy and still does, based in Bedford, we have to say, not anywhere near our city, thankfully.
Yeah. But standing to be MP in our city,
indeed,
coming in with your poisonous ideas from Bedford,
yes,
isn't acceptable. Yeah. And I believe she still believes these things.
I think she does. I think she does. And also there was an incident in Eastbourne with the defeated Conservative candidate who had an intern from the same organisation. So, you know, to some extent, at least the Liberal Democrats managed to get back in there.
I think there are moments when you read stories like this and you think it's a shame Brighton hasn't got a village pond, because a ducking stool would be an appropriate way of dealing with people who come out with this spurious nonsense.
This is very worrying. This is very worrying, although, you know, there is obviously moves to stop it from the World Health Organization and others, and that seems to be generated by this Chinese man, Zhao Zhen, who has actually suing an organisation who tried to say he could be cured, he could be gay cured. And this has forced some closures in Ecuador, in Argentina, and the French government being, you know, promoting this kind of stopping.
Yeah.
But I mean, there are rumours that something like 100,000 men could be affected by this type of behaviour in of these clinics in China alone, you know, and you know, this is terrible.
It's also not just sort of verbal therapies. Some of these are quite invasive procedures, electric shock therapy, repulsion therapies involving pain.
I mean, and given we've just had this 50th anniversary of the decriminalisation, and we've seen some of the dramas and docudramas that have been presented by, you know, mainstream TV, BBC and Channel 4, showing some of what happened in the 50s and 60s to gay men when they got arrested, etc., etc. This is a throwback over 50 years to some of these places.
I think it's also interesting because this is actually, you know, in Ecuador, they're shutting down 200 clinics. Mm. The French are very against it. But how many clinics, how many organisations are there in our own country, in the UK, doing this? Because it's a bit of a hidden statistic, I think.
Yes. Well, that would be interesting to find out. I don't know of very many, and I think that's good news.
We don't know about them, but I suspect that underneath the surface, there are quite a lot of organisations, and I hate to say it, probably tied to faiths.
Well, I was about to say, Andrew, that If it is happening here, it is the kind of Bedford Church that we talked about at the start of this story, rather than clinics themselves promoting it. I don't think here there would be necessarily clinics trying to promote a gay cure, but could there be in some of the faiths? Well,
I suspect,
as we know, there are some churches who do believe that. They tend to be on the right of religious faith.
Pretty pretty
shocking. Not a good story.
Not a good story.
No.
And if any of you out there know of any of those, please get in touch with me, because I would love to have you on the show talking about this kind of invasive intrusion into our utterly normal lives. So please.
And also
get in touch.
Say, it's the one thing positive from this is the World Health Organization coming out and starting to take an active role and in stopping this kind of thing being health related. That's really, really important.
And I think it's great what's happening in France. That is wonderful.
Yeah,
but it would be really good if we had a very openly heterosexual leader of a major government coming out and saying the same thing, rather than someone we know who is actually very pro-LGBT issues. We need someone who stands on the other side of the fence a little.
Yeah. Well, maybe Chancellor Merkel. Do you have a bit of leadership across Europe, do you think, after she's re-elected in September?
I think
I'm making an assumption there about the German election.
That she will.
Yeah.
Well, one hopes so in a way, don't we?
Yeah.
This is an interesting and a small story. But the telecommunications company Orange has been caught advertising on the website of a major Ugandan tabloid known for leading an anti-gay witch hunt in the country. Now, this witch hunt was worse than anti-gay. This was promoting violence, promoting people going out and actually physically harming people that they suspected
of being gay.
Of being gay.
That's the point, yes.
It's terrible. And this is coming from All Out. Now, All Out is an organisation which is online presence that I've joined, which is putting forward and pushing all these issues from around the world and asking people to get behind them and support them. And I've found a few stories on there recently that have been deeply distressing, and hats off to them for what they're doing. It's wonderful.
They are. I mean, I see some of their stuff as well, just because I like to know what's going on, obviously. This is worrying. I mean, it's a concern for Orange that they got, you know, duped into this to some extent. And they, and to be fair to Orange, they pulled the
advert.
They
have actually severed all their contact with this tabloid.
Indeed. So well done to them. I mean, there is stuff online here where people like Stop Homophobia are actually still campaigning against advertising in certain papers. We won't actually name the papers because there may be legal issues around that. But I think that kind of whole Stop the Hate campaign is relevant both here to the British press, and of course overseas to organisations like this. It's very easy in a big conglomerate to be caught out like this, and that's what Orange has happened to them. And I think the one thing that you always say to big conglomerates is, if you get caught out, don't keep digging. And what Orange have done is to stop,
put your hands
and
up,
say, we made a mistake, we're out of here, end of story.
Absolutely.
And so well done to Orange on this.
I think well done to Orange and well done to All Out. And it is very, very worth joining that organisation online. Doesn't cost anything. You can contribute if you wish to, but it doesn't cost anything to join. Right. And you do get updated on global issues.
Yeah, indeed.
I think I want to move on, really, because this weekend we saw a massive story break, which is about the Metropolitan Police paying out to certain lords who had been defamed, I think, in a massive child abuse. What do you call it?
Scandal.
Scandal.
I think.
It is a scandal, and this has affected the ex-head of the army, Lord Bramall, and Lord Britton, and
Harvey Proctor.
Harvey Proctor, who is still actively protesting.
He is
not happy with what's been offered.
We should say immediately, of course, it's Lord Britton's family who've been...
because
he's passed away before this was concluded. I have to say, Lord Bramall is someone I spoke to at length when I joined Ministry of Defence. He was the previous Chief of the General Staff, and I took it upon myself to understand from him more about the military, because when you're effectively a civilian going in to be responsible for military personnel, I think you owe it to them to know as much as possible about their lifestyles. And he was extremely helpful to me. And when this story first broke, I think what struck me is that Lord Bramall made the point himself that he was very content to answer any questions or to be investigated. But it's the way the investigation was handled in a glare of publicity by the Met Police and by the accusatory tone of this character, Nick, that I think said to him, to the Britton family and to Harvey Proctor, this is just wrong. And what the Met Police got wrong, which they've accepted they got wrong, is they didn't do enough in-depth analysis of Nick and his cohort of people who were involved.
They took them at their word.
They took them at their word. And this is one of the failures of abuse allegations, in that there are always two sides. Mm-hmm. It's essential, let's just say this, be really clear. If there is child abuse of any sort, it has to be stopped. But at the same time, we can't have widespread publicity about famous people who are actually with an investigation that's not correct. And that's what's happened here. So I feel strongly supportive of Lord Bramall and Harvey Proctor and the Britton family. And at least there is some element of closure now on this for them.
One has to hope so. I mean, I would also provocatively suggest that had they not gone in quite so hard and the result had been the opposite and Nick had been proved to be telling the truth, then we might be talking a different story here.
Of course we would.
And so it is really important. I wouldn't want the police to step back from investigating thoroughly.
There's nothing wrong with either Met Police or our police force carrying out investigations, and they should.
Goes out to the victims of this spurious claim.
Yeah.
It's been pretty grim.
Yeah.
Let's hope Harvey sorts it out and
gets the result he wants. I'm sure he will.
But for now, that's all we've got time for. Thank you for coming in, Ivor.
Pleasure.
We'll see you again in a week's time. But for now, that's all from Queer Say. Good night.